But now to less controversial matters. Jeremy Clarkson's been to a sale at the National Motor Museum at Bewley, which turned out to be light years away from a conventional classic car auction.
In 23 years, Bewley Auto Jumble has grown from something very parochial and afternoon tea-ish into something absolutely vast. Predictably, only the Americans do it bigger, and they probably wear brighter clothes too. Over 45,000 people are going to come here this weekend. Traders, enthusiasts, junk hunters, eccentrics, and of course the inevitable cowboys. It's reckoned that over £3 million is going to change hands. An auto jumble is somewhere people come to buy and sell and swap anything to do with motoring. That means pretty well everything from a Sunbeam track rod end to a fully restored Mark II Jaguar.
This is a Jaguar that is restored in New Zealand. They're built to order. It's about a 6 month delivery period. And they're quite a lot cheaper than the English restored equivalent cars.
But it's not only cars.
It's amazing. Sometimes they turn up in a box, all in pieces, rusty, and they finish up like that beautiful Rover there. You see, that was rebuilt. And they are so... You can't believe it when you see how rusty they can be and how beautiful they finish.
People are trying to sell vintage cars and veteran cars and cars that people hope one day will be classics, and what on earth is this? It's a marina. Explain.
They're a car that's developed by Morris Thousand in a couple of years. Who knows, they may be as sought after as Morris Thousands. But you can drive one of these, get the same performance as an MGB, and have fun.
But of course most people are here for the bits. With over 1,500 stalls here, it's nearly impossible to find anything specific, and particularly when they all look broadly like this. I mean, what on earth is this? And this, for instance, if you have an Austin 7, you'll probably recognise it as a piece of timing gear. If you don't, well, then it looks a bit like a piece of metal that belongs on a scrap heap. Know what I mean?
It's just a question of rummaging around and finding it. You know, that's the situation, really.
It's off a Mays. I bought it for an A10 combination. So it's just a ticket, which I want, really. It's good. I couldn't get it, you know, built for anything like that.
You're going to make it yourself?
Well, no, that's it. I'm just going to bolt that straight into the front of my bike.
Today's ideal. You can come along and just rake round the boxes and find what you need. And slowly but surely, we're kitting out a full toolkit.
I have a Frogger's Pride and an MGA.
And there's no way you could buy stuff for them in Germany?
Oh, yes, you can, but you'll find these things easier here.
But do you have auto jumbles in Germany?
Yes, we have.
Big as this one?
Not as big as this one, and the atmosphere is not as good as here.
And you're after a Sprite seat. I know this, because look. It seems to me that some of these prices are a result of dealers selling to each other. Trader A buys something from Trader B, even before the show is open, and the increased cost is passed on to Joe Public.
Right, business has been very good. We took a fair amount before we opened the doors this morning. And let's hope it continues all day.
Hey, plenty.
Never.
Yes. Got 14 and 9 on there. Well, all right then. You give me the 14 and 9, you can have it.
10 shillings?
He's only got the 14 and 9,
hasn't he? Quid for that.
You're not having, it's too late, mate. He's already done it.
He's 14 and 9, point, so, you know, you can't argue, can
right.
you? 10 shillings. 12 and 6.
You never expected this, did you?
13 and 6. Three pence pieces is 14 and 9 pence.
Thank you very much.
Well, there you are, sir.
Thank you very much.
Fit. That's very nice, thank you.
Ah, I know what this is. It's a tail lamp of a Mark 1 Cortina, which I suppose were all the rage when this auto jumble first started.
I happen to be the first spectator to go through the gate. All that long time ago, and I think Lord Montague said, come back, and I said, well, sorry, too late, I'm off.
Now, all I wanted was an Alfa Romeo windscreen wiper. Did I get one? No, but I'm not that bothered, because I picked this up. Good, isn't it? And then there's a little something to get us both home.
Well, over the past 2 years, when Grand Prix racing has seemed rather more like a McLaren benefit race than anything else, most of the excitement from televised motorsport has come from grandstand's regular coverage of the Esso British Touring Car Championship. All the fastest cars are Sierras, although a long way away, of course, from the conventional reps car, or indeed this rather more powerful 4x4 version. Tiff Needell has been having a go.
Tiff Needell, ex-Grand Prix driver, into the Sierra, out of the pit lane, into the race. And that was a really slick pit stop. Excellent work. And there's contact, there's a nudge, and off goes Van Kaan into the sand trap. Cluddy's kept the Sierra rolling, and there is Tiff Needell through in the lead. As Harvey comes out of the pits, Soper takes Jones, and there's contact between Pinkney and Smith, and Soper.
Every man's dream, taking the checkered flag. But that win earlier this year was my only victory so far this season. And, unless you're Senna or Prost, winning doesn't come easily. But what is a Group A touring car? Well, you start with a model of which at least 5,000 cars have been built in 1 year. One such model is this, the Ford Sierra RS Cosworth. It's a pretty impressive car in its standard trim. But for Group A, you are allowed one or two minor modifications. Modifications began with this, an evolution special. The regulations permit a manufacturer to build 500 specials and incorporate those modifications on the racing car, hence the RS500 Cosworth. Now we have this larger rear wing, the whale tail, two-tier. In the engine, there's a larger turbocharger and larger intercooler, which allows the power to be raised from 200 horsepower to 225. The front spoiler now has a lower chin for aerodynamics and also more ducting to increase the airflow into the coolers. And so we come to the racing model itself. There's now slick racing tyres, racing brakes, and very firm racing suspension. In the engine bay, well, there's a lot of heat shielding, there's a lot of this aircraft specification high-pressure piping, there's a mechanical fuel pump, and also there's a very well-tuned engine, the same engine albeit, but now producing 500 horsepower. Finally, and most important in most racing cars, are the sponsors' colour schemes and logos. Here is the car that I won that race back in May with Lawrence Bristow, and in this case, it's a Canadian brewer with a very important message. Inside, all the trim is stripped out. The massive rollover cage for safety. The piping laid inside for protection. For the driver, the gear lever. Beside it, the brake balance adjuster, and also an anti-roll bar adjustment which helps the handling whilst driving. The racing seat holding the driver firmly in place and straight ahead the steering wheel. Now what else do we need? Ah, that's better. Now, let's see what it's like.
Formula. Unlike single seaters or Group C, it's not a car that's designed for racing alone. It's a compromise. It's a road car made into a racing car. With these engines race tuned, you've got 500 horsepower to hold on the road, but the regulations limit the amount of tyres you're allowed to have, the tyre width. So getting 500 horsepower down onto the road in what's basically a saloon car causes quite a few interesting situations. The suspension is relatively soft. You can't get the torsional rigidity that a racing car provides because the body shell is full of holes, so you have to make do as best you can. Suspension, of course, still very stiff compared with the road car, but there's an awful lot of wheel waving, and steering wheel work to be done in a Group A car. Braking is a much longer braking area as well as a racing car. So, all in all, you need a lot more road in a Group A car than perhaps you do in a Packer racer. To understeer into the corners and then snapping to oversteer when the brute power of 500 horsepower is applied. And that was applying a little bit too much, too soon.